I'm Elvis Mitchell, and on this episode of Deep Cuts, the evolution of the Muppets from comedy material to something much more foreboding and revolutionary.
Another world, another time, in the age of wonder.
The opening narration of the 1982 fantasy film, The Dark Crystal, could be a description of the kind of enchantment puppets draw upon. In every culture, from ancient Greece to the Edo Society of Japan, puppet theater allowed artists to display the hunger of the id under a proscenium arch. It's been a long road for puppets in America, and they're chiefly recognized these days as a brand name. A brand name that has straddled the line between kids' entertainment and sophistication since their creation. That name is the Muppets. Jim Henson created a new type of creature choreography when he brought his Muppets to TV, combining the theatricality of vaudeville and the intimacy of television to make something wholly other. Each iteration of the Muppets, from appearances on old-school variety shows to Sesame Street to the Muppet Show to the Muppet Movie, was a step further in developing deeper, richer scenarios. Until finally, in 1982, The Dark Crystal gave audiences a tableau in which humans were supplanted by a world made entirely of Jim Henson creations, down to the plants. His daughter, Lisa Henson, who now runs the Henson Company, reflects on that.
I remember my father was asked, well, what is the meaning of The Dark Crystal? And he wouldn't even answer at all. He would just be like, oh no, I don't want to discuss what anything means. People should just watch it and feel the meaning for themselves. I feel like we have to be wary of being pretentious, particularly when we're doing puppet production. People are like worried they're either going to be creepy and bored, it's just going to be like ridiculous and childish.
Each iteration of what he did with Muppets was about sort of getting audiences to invest more and to sort of say, listen, this medium can offer as much of the human experience as live action can.
Mm-hmm. We have to be very careful about tone. You know, we don't want to tell people like, this is an important show because it's puppets. Like they're going to say things people can't say. They can do things people can't do. I mean, that's the whole point of Punch and Judy. Punch is doing incredibly awful things and people are just laughing, watching it. But if it was a person doing that whole routine, you would be shocked by it.
Henson's ambition to innovate created worlds, from appearances on Sesame Street to The Muppet Show. But the Muppets broke new ground with the little-known grim fantasy Land of Gorch on Saturday Night Live.
There is a little bit of comedy, but it's not like joke comedy. That didn't work on Saturday Night Live. So it was sort of this brief thing that came and went. But my father wanted to experiment with other sorts of textures. And he started using sort of much more realistic treatment on the outside of the puppets. They had glass eyes that were painted to look more realistic. You know, it wasn't just creating puppets that were more believable, but also animating the whole environment, sculpting and casting, you know, the plants, the rocks, and creating this idea that the whole environment was alive.
Still, seeing that world and how much attention was paid to each aspect of it. I mean, it's like almost like his entire career was building up a rehearsal for Dark Crystal in some way, wasn't it?
He was tremendously curious about trying new things and his desire to do something very different with puppetry, to create something more real, more authentic, or maybe believable. Like you look at it and say, oh, it's believable in its own environment. He kept that going after the failure of The Land of Gorch. And after years and years of R&D and creative development, ultimately became The Dark Crystal.
That's always been the excitement, that there's always been so much ambition in the Muppets in terms of just sort of pushing back boundaries and making people think that you can offer something more than what they were used to from puppets.
Yeah, you know, my father found Dark Crystal to be both the most exciting thing that he did, the most rewarding, but at the same time, very challenging when he presented it to the public. This is not what you expect, but you'll enjoy it. Muppets and puppets don't have to be just one thing. One important collaborator for my father was Brian Froud. It was really when my father saw his artwork that he thought, this is like a kind of image that I could bring to life in film. That sort of fantasy landscape, the creature, how it fits in the environment. I think it was partially meeting Brian and getting excited about that imagery that ignited his creative juices to start to put it all together like that. And then we were lucky enough to have Brian Froud come back. And that is our most important connection to the past production on our new series. So he and his wife, Wendy Froud, who he met on the movie, who designed the Gelfling characters, they and their son, Toby Froud, all worked on the show as our kind of main design team.
For years, there have been storied attempts to revive Dark Crystal, including a feature film follow-up that would have been something a little different from the original movie.
I don't know if he knew or if anybody knew that the movie would continue to have this cult status that it had. It's just like maintained its popularity for so many years. And I think it's just because nobody ever tried to do anything like it. There were no copycat movies. There's no like faux Dark Crystal. Like nobody even tried it. Like there's nothing.
So there was originally talk about this being an animated series, mm-hmm. and then they came back and said, how about doing a live action?
Actually, we were pursuing parallel development of a sequel film, which would be with puppets, and then a prequel television series, and that would have been animated. So we were sort of thinking about that and presented that to Netflix. And Ted Biaselli at Netflix was an advocate of that, as well as everything Dark Crystal. He came back and said, well, I've got, I think, great news for you. We want to do it with a series, 10 nearly hour-long episodes with puppets. The idea of doing puppetry along the lines of the feature film was going to be a gigantic project and a huge undertaking and kind of expensive. So we said, are you really aware what you're asking for? With the Age of Resistance, we've actually made it much bigger. By going back into a prequel period of time, we're showing a world where Thra is not all crumbling and dark and decaying. It's a much more vibrant, colorful world. It's much more populous. There's so many puppets.
It was evident that all roads would lead Henson back to Dark Crystal, if only because it touched on material that was kind of a thematic legacy. We go from each world being bigger and deeper to the Muppet movies and actually having the characters ride bicycles and all that kind of stuff. Kind of felt like what you guys were doing was trying to train audiences to think of puppets as more than just puppets.
Yeah, the challenge with something like Dark Crystal is for people to really suspend their disbelief. More than when the Muppets interact with actors. Because for instance, if the Muppets are interacting with actors, you're well aware that they're not the same. You know, this is a person, this is a puppet. But when you go into the Dark Crystal, it's all puppets. Our goal is for people to really suspend their disbelief and kind of just go with it, maybe hopefully forget that they are puppets. Now that we're blending the puppets with so much CG in the backgrounds, it's really, we hope, creating a very complex kind of image where maybe your eye doesn't know exactly what it's seeing, like how much of that is puppetry, how much of it is the CG background, how much is the real set. And we don't want people even to think about it. But because it is a kind of a complex image, I think you will hopefully just get drawn into it and allowed to feel that it's real.
But again, if we look at the beginning of the Dark Crystal movie, and it still sticks with me, how subtly we're brought into that world. He really takes his time.
Part of it was also necessity. The puppets had very little mobility. You know, like the the Mystics and the Skeksis characters were hauling cables and people around, and they had to be hidden under everything. So one of the things we embraced right away is that our characters can be more nimble. Even the Skeksis can scuttle down a hall, whereas before they walked really, really slowly. Just with some basic green screen removal and puppeteer removal, we were able to puppeteer the puppets in all kinds of action chase scenes, fighting, flying. We've given them a kind of mobility, which was not possible at all back in the time of the original films.
What supported the idea of bringing Dark Crystal back was also the knowledge that so many people had grown up with the film as a formative influence. Percentage-wise, how much of the talent came to this project having been huge fans of the original?
Oh, 100% of everybody. Everybody who worked on the show was a fan of the film. Louis Leterrier, our director, and Taryn were sharing stories of how much the movie terrified them when they were kids.
I know that Taryn Edgerton was really invested in this.
Well, he came to us very, very early. He loved the Dark Crystal so much, and he loves puppets. He really respected the art of the puppetry, and he really understood also that the performance was ultimately going to be a collaboration between the puppeteer and the voice artist. The puppeteers are really actors. All the subtlety that you see on screen is from the puppeteer, and then we had to voice cast people who complemented that perfectly and had the voice character that we wanted. Every voice is somebody amazing.
Yes.
And that actually is something we didn't entirely predict. In fact, we were originally planning just to have the maybe lead five puppets be voiced by celebrities and the rest would be voice artists. But after we got Taryn Edgerton, we started getting one more star, another star, another star, and then suddenly we realized we're gonna have a star play every role, we think, you know? it wasn't originally the intention. Amongst the Gelfling, we really went for British movie stars and British performers so that they feel that they are of a culture together. With the Skeksis, we really just wanted to go big. Like, we have Awkwafina as a Skeksis. We have Harvey Fierstein as a Skeksis. Mark Hamill, you know, his character of the scientist, he's angry, he's resentful, but he's also horrible and torturing. We have the best villains of all in Dark Crystal.
Puppetry has met social turmoil with a response, tradition that Jim Henson followed, perhaps even unconsciously. And the newest edition of Dark Crystal has allowed a chance to do that again, keeping the conversation alive while constantly exploding the definition of what puppetry is.